Today we've got two stories to go over, and the first will be the history. Now, I don't know about you guys, but I thought this chapter, if you listened to it, if you read it, was a really good chapter. And hold on a second, where's my book? I can't find my book. Just a second. So who read the book or listened to the story? We were supposed to listen to the chapter called Friends in High Places, Chapter 9. Who listened to it? Marwa, did you listen?
He returns. Yeah, I listened to it, and
Was
I
it
begin my summarizing, but I haven't finished it yet.
Oh, that's okay. Was it an easier chapter for you, or was it still difficult?
No, it's easier than the previous one.
Yes, and they talk a lot about Egypt.
Yeah.
Did you listen that far? Did you hear that part?
Yeah,
Very good, very good.
about especially the stone.
That's right. Yes. The steels and the stones and the hieroglyphs.
Yeah,
Yeah, very interesting
which
stuff.
written in three languages. Yeah,
That's right. Who else listened to the chapter? We've got a bunch of people. Who else listened?
Oh, I read.
You read it. Did you like the chapter?
Oh, I think it was one of easy.
Exact. I agree. I thought so too. I thought it was one of the easier chapters.
So the language was quite understandable.
Yes, I agree. Mahmoud, what did you think?
Yeah, this is easy. No, not easy.
Easier.
No, at the first time I thought I don't make summary, but after that I do it.
So the first time you listened, you said no way, but then you said okay.
Yeah. Really, I make some search on the net to understand the story, and yeah, that's helped me.
That's good. That's good. It's actually not that bad. The story itself is pretty self-explanatory. It's not in too much detail. So Santa, did anybody send you a summary? The hero returns. Eva and S only Eva?
Yeah, so far only Eva sent me the summary, my email, unless other people have it already. Like, I mean, in the
Yeah, chapter
I
eight. That's
haven't
right.
seen that.
Okay. And I'm looking. You're showing us two pages. Can you make it bigger and show us one page, please? Perfect, perfect. And Eva, would you go ahead and read your summary for us?
Yes, but I can see. I should see. See.
You'll get it in a second here.
Okay. So, can I start?
Yes.
Okay.
Oh,
Just
Santi, you gotta keep it steady there. Okay.
no. I need it. Okay, that's enough. So, Chapter 8 describes the return journey of the corpse of discovery. This was not easy because of some reasons. First, natural and weather conditions threatened them to die of starvation. Then Lois and Clark decided to part in two teams in order to find a way out of the situation. Lois and his men had chosen moving by boats, and on their way they met different native tribes unexpected behavior, who several times turned out to be sly. An unexplained versus injury made it worse. Santa, can you move it? please. Okay, thank you. The Clark's group was more successful because it was able to find food by hunting wild animals and foraging plants in the forest. After the two groups of the corps got together, they moved east. This part of their expedition was rich in exploring animals and plants. They also went by other important traces of the past civilization, but they did not explore them. The author here writes about Dr. Barry Fell, the professor, historian, who devoted his work to show the connections between Native Americans and Asian cultures from Europe, Egypt, and Asia before Columbus appeared on American continent.
Oh, that was really good. You did it in two paragraphs, which is actually really tough. Excellent job. Very, very pleased.
Oh, thank you very much.
Yes.
I have more paragraphs, but I sometimes put it together.
No, that's okay. I was going to say, I wished you had talked more about Lewis and his difficulties, but actually that's okay. In a summary, you don't have to talk about everything, but I really liked it. Go ahead.
Somebody else could concentrate on these things.
Yes, exactly. Hopefully somebody else can send us something. Yes.
And okay. Also about the last, I thought about Marwa.
Hey, me too. Yeah, when I saw the stuff from Egypt, I thought about Marwa too. Exactly, me too. And she works in Alexandria, which is obviously the home of the great library there, which probably
also me.
There you go. There you go.
My mother from Egypt.
Ah, your mother's from Egypt. Where in Egypt?
And Cairo.
In Cairo, right by the pyramids.
Yes, yes, we have an apartment there.
Oh, that's great. So you are Yemen, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, you're all over the place.
Also, I have two passports, one Yemen, one Egypt.
So what are you doing in Saudi Arabia?
I don't know. I don't know.
There.
No, because I born here in Saudi Arabia.
You're born there. Okay. All right. Okay. So I want to talk about a couple of things here. And Andre already asked one of the questions that I'm going to address. And that is the word C-O-R-P-S. C-O-R-P-S. Barack Obama pronounces the word as corpse, which is absolutely incorrect. C-O-R-P-S is not corpse. Corpse is C-O-R-P-S-E, which means a dead body. That's absolutely not what we're talking about here. C-O-R-P-S is pronounced core. The P and the S are silent. Sorry. It's just C-O-R-E, the same pronunciation as C-O-R-E, core, and it means a group, especially a professional group. So the Corps of Engineers, professional group of engineers, the Marine Corps, the professional group of fighting Marines. This is the idea of a corps. The P and the S are silent. So be careful with that word. If you say corpse, you are referring to a dead body. there's another word I want to talk about too. Santa, can you write this down? Petroglyphs. P-E-T-R-O-G-L-Y-P-H-S. And let me go back to Eva. Eva, can you tell me anything about the word petroglyphs?
So I think it's a kind of letters.
Great.
But I don't know more. So everything which is ending with glyphs.
Yeah, glyphs. It's so, there you go. So petroglyphs are basically picture alphabet, a picture alphabet. So the most famous petroglyphs are what we call in Egypt. Yeah, and what are those called? Let's go back to Egypt. Let's go to Marwa. What are the famous Egyptian petroglyphs called? Marwa?
Hieroglyphics.
Yeah, in America we say hieroglyphics. How do you pronounce it?
Okay, I would say it as you, hieroglyphics.
Well, I'm asking, what is your pronunciation?
Okay, hieroglyphics.
Okay. Okay. Uh-huh. Yep. So our pronunciation, that's right, Santa. Good. A picture alphabet. Hieroglyphs. So Santa, write this. Hieroglyphics are the most famous type. Now, actually, when we say petroglyphs, we think of people before the Egyptians. So we go way back to the cavemen, you know, to that type of era. And there are many petroglyphs found throughout the United States or North America. And scientists always believed these petroglyphs were created by the American Indians. But is it Dr. Full? Who was it, Eva? Dr. Full? What's his name? F-U-L-L, is that right? Santa, take me back up there to Eva's. Dr. Fell. Thank you. Okay, we can go back down. Yeah, let's go back down. Dr. Fell suggested that the petroglyphs were related to ancient Egypt and ancient Phoenicia. Spell that, Santa. P-H-O. And I gotta check Google here. Phoenicia. P-H-O-E-N-I-C-I-A. P-H-O-E-N-I-C-I-A. There you go. From ancient Egypt and ancient Phoenicia, also related perhaps to the Celtics or Celtics. We can say Celtic runes, Celtic runes. How do you spell runes? R-U-N-E-S. R-U-N-E-S. Do we say Celtic runes? I'm just checking it. Yeah, Celtic runes.
Hey, Shane.
Yes.
So petroglyphs, it's only carved in stone and hieroglyph. Well, I don't know how to pronounce it. It's just a picture.
Your petroglyphs.
Because petros is from stone in Greek.
Yeah, but the hieroglyphs are also carved in stone. So. So yeah, let's petroglyphs versus hieroglyphs. I'm gonna see if there's a difference here. Last longer. I think they're still the same thing. Hieroglyphs are just the Egyptian form of petroglyphs. Petroglyphs are just really ancient. I think that's the best way to look at it. very, very ancient, before the Egyptian world. I mean, extremely ancient. Now, some people will say the hieroglyphs are a form of petroglyphs. Petroglyphs are more like Santa's picture there, less artistic. I guess that's the way to look at it. But yeah. So I'm sorry. I don't know if I'm answering your question. Adriana, one more time, ask the question.
I wasn't sure if petroglyph is just the fact that it has to be carved on stone or in any other surface.
You know what? Like you said, it is carved in stone. Petro means stone and glyph means picture. However, I'm sure when we look at runes, R-U-N-E-S, they have discovered runes on wood, but that wood has miraculously survived thousands of years, you know, under, it was frozen or something like that. They still call those petroglyphs or runes. They use the same word, but phonetically, rather, the definition itself is carved in stone, because stone is the only thing that lasts forever. So by saying petroglyphs carved in stone, it gives you that idea of super, super, super ancient. So that's the term we use. If we had super, super, super ancient trees, then they might use a different word. But we don't. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Pictogram is a modern word, and it's going to basically kind of have the same idea. So when you take a bunch of pictures and put them together, now you have like a pictogram. So it's like a telegram. You take a bunch of words or letters and put it together for a message. A pictogram is going to be the same idea. So if we look at hieroglyphs, we can see that these symbols create a story. So we could call that a pictogram. But actually, that's not true, because the hieroglyphs are actually a type of alphabet. A individual hieroglyph might be considered a pictogram in some situations, but not in every situation. I recommend, unless you're interested in archaeology, you don't ask too many questions, because it's going to be confusing. The syntax and semantics of these words get a little confusing. This is an area that I am personally very interested in, though. So once again, I'll just try and be real simple. A petroglyph is simply a picture a caveman drew thousands of years ago. A hieroglyph is actually more of an alphabet that the ancient Egyptians used to write their history and everything. One hieroglyph can have several meanings. Hieroglyphs have been translated. Petroglyphs, generally, have not been translated. I hope that makes sense. Questions on that stuff? Now, so once again, I think everybody understands what's happening here. So in ancient America, I'll turn my camera on so I can summarize this. So in ancient America, they traveled around and they found these petroglyphs here and there. They found petroglyphs in many different areas. And everybody thought, oh, it's American Indians made the petroglyphs. But then there's this Dr. Fell, who studied the petroglyphs And he realized, oh, wait, this is the same as in Phoenicia. This over here, this one's the same as in Egypt. Oh, this one is the same as in the Celtic area, in Scotland and that area. So these are not American Indian originating petroglyphs. These are actually hieroglyphs and Phoenician alphabet and Celtic runes. Okay, so this is like shocking information. So the question is, why don't Americans know about this? And the answer is simple, really simple. So they found some Egyptian hieroglyphs on a stone in Ohio. And it was, actually they were Roman coins, but the same thing with the hieroglyphs. But anyway, they found some coins, Roman coins from, you know, the year 100 in Ohio. They were at a museum and people could come and see ancient Roman coins found in Ohio. So before Columbus. But after 2 years, the government went to the museum and said, no, you have to remove that because according to the Smithsonian Institute, those coins could not exist, so you have to remove them. Somebody else put the coins there. Romans didn't come and do that. So the Smithsonian Institute basically has taken all of these Roman coins, Egyptian hieroglyphs, Celtic runes, Phoenician inscriptions, taken all of that stuff and removed it from the university, the museums where children go to study. They took it from the museums. Why? Because the Smithsonian said, no. Columbus discovered America. Before Columbus, there were only American Indians. American Indians did not have a writing system. They did not have money. The only thing they have was petroglyphs on cave walls, and that's it. There are no coins. There are no hieroglyphs. There are no steels. None of that. So you're lying to the children of America. Therefore, get it out of the museum. Boom. End of story. So that's why Americans don't know about this. You can find out if you study, but it's not easy. Isn't that interesting?
Yes. No. It's a question. I don't know.
it's a big mystery, right?
Yes, I also have a question. What was the reason for suppressing this? Because, you know, there is discoveries and exploring, it goes on and it can be changed what was said many years ago because of this discoveries. Yes?
Yep.
Why? So I can't see any reason.
Okay, this is, yeah, I agree with you.
So
and this
do they have to rewrite the books, the students' books?
No, that's part of it. That's the thing is, when it comes to history, history is very interesting. And as you know, history is written by the winner. The winner writes the history. The winner decides what the history is. And we have to go back to the Smithsonian. The Smithsonian Institute is a government-run institute. It's the government's propaganda for history lessons. They have huge investment on the credibility of the institute. What the Smithsonian says is like the Bible. It's the Bible for American history. And people do not like it when you change the Bible. You can, and this is just one example. There are many, many examples of this in history. And I'll give you one more example. I have to get the name. I want to get the name first. Do you know, is it Misra? Hold up. No. What is it? Invictus. I'm looking up something. Just a second, guys. Oh, my goodness. I can't remember the name, which is important. Oh, there's an ancient religion that was very popular in Rome and the Middle East. And it was based on the sun, the S-U-N, sun. Mithraic, there you go, Mithraic, yes. Mithraism, not, okay. So Mithras, the god Mithras. And I'll write that M-I-T-H-R-A-S, yes, Mithras. And what's really interesting about Mithras is the similarity to Jesus. The birth date, just the stories. And the stories are endless. There are so many similarities. And Mithraism is actually much older than Christianity. But of course, the Roman Catholics who invested their and existence on Jesus completely got rid of Mithraism. And they said anybody who believes in Mithraism is an idiot. So they destroyed all of that history. And now science continues to find more of the Mithraism history. And the stories in Mithraism not only show Jesus, but they also talk about the other characters of the Bible. Even if you go to Egyptian history and the history of Osiris's life and the life of Jesus are really like the same. I mean, the number of similarities is huge. But again, the Catholic Church says, no, that's something else. Forget about that stuff. Anybody who believes that is an idiot. And they've said that for, 2,000 years. So now, people who are Christians, even if they hear about Mithra or Osiris, they say, yeah, but no, that's not true. So even though we hear about this history, we deny it. And this is what the Smithsonian is doing for over 100 years. Even though we have this other information, the Smithsonian is suppressing it so that they can form the story. That's why the book is called The Suppressed History. The Catholic Church suppressed Mithraism and suppressed Osiris and the ancient religions. But they did it for 2,000 years, so we don't even think about that. So the Smithsonian Institute, if they do it for a long enough time, people don't even think about it. And it's complicated, but that's the idea. Oh, and they have many Viking. Yeah, Alex asks, right, Rehab, I agree. Yeah, Rehab has a point, too. I'll go Alex first. Vikings visited America before Columbus. Couldn't they bring some ancient coins with them? Absolutely. And, Alex, they have found many Viking camps in America. But you're not going to see it in the history books. They suppress it. They found it, especially up in Newfoundland, Canada, and Maine. Lots of Viking settlements, camps. So, and runes and markings, things that they wrote. They found those too. Rehab says, I don't believe in history. Yeah. History, it's best to look at both sides if you can, but the problem is usually only the winner writes the history. So that's why I love history, because it's like science. There's no fact. It's theory, all theory. And some theories are really good. Probably we can believe them. But some theories are just theories. They're just ideas. And this history of America is interesting. Personally, I'm much more interested in ancient history, but this is a really good book, and I'm very much enjoying it. Unfortunately, do you think many Americans know about this book? Nobody. Adrian has a great point. I believe it's a justification for genocide, making us believe they didn't have any culture, that they were just barbarians. Without a doubt, absolutely. This is part of the Smithsonian theme of education, was the American Indians, North America, Central America specifically, were, you know, barbarian. They didn't have any clothes. They wore animal fur and paint and feathers in their hair. And, you know, they were just savages, and, you know, they were this barely human, basically animals. That's what American children are taught today. And obviously, it is so not true. They were not perhaps as sophisticated as Europeans, you know, I guess, you know, things were different, but we actually don't know, we're still finding out what they were actually like. So yeah, absolutely. Part of the propaganda is America came and Europe came, Spain and Portugal, England came to America, and these poor people had no money, had no clothes, life was terrible, they lived in dirt, and we brought education and religion, and we helped them, you know, have a happy life. This is what we're taught. That's what we learn. But I don't think it's the whole story. It's not the whole story. Obviously, it's not the whole story. That's why history is fun. I'm looking at what Santa's doing. Santa's got the toughest job in the world. All right. Any other comments or questions? Yeah. Comments or questions on
chapter 7? Go ahead. Me? Yeah, I want to say that I met the manager of the Smithsonian Institute, I think, 2 years later.
2 years ago.
Two years ago, yeah.
in the library, for example.
He's a very nice person, right? I can't hear.
I don't know. I just present my work. This is... I just presented my work. We work on the Antiquities Museum.
If you have a chance to meet the manager in the future, you should ask them, please tell me about the hieroglyphs that were discovered in ancient America during the Lewis and Clark expedition.
If there is a chance.
You know nothing! There's no hieroglyphs!
Of course. If there is a chance. I think that my part is very short. I have a very short period of time. So I just present my work and that's it, you know?
Yeah, yeah. It's probably best.
Oh, thank you.
Eva's also saying, yeah, I agree, Eva. Yeah. It was also kind of presumption on the expedition. That's right. It was. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. That's very true. The general idea is America doesn't have an ancient history. It's absolutely true. It's the new world, okay? And that's what we learn. That's what we learn in school. That's what children are taught. And now, just little by little, we're starting to hear there was a lot more happening. There was a huge amount of people that had cities, culture, development, and who knows what else. They may have had much, much more. So I hope that we continue to learn about that. Okay, so next week, we're going slow. We're only taking a chapter at a time, and I don't mind that. Let me know if you guys do want to go faster. The next chapter is chapter 9. I'm telling you guys, I read it and I listen to it. So usually I listen to it when I go exercise, and then I read it. Like yesterday, I read it. Friends in High Places, chapter 9. That is our next chapter. Chapter 9, Friends in High Places. Yeah. For this book. Now, we also have the other book. Santa, what's the other book?
But Mahmoud has also a summary of this chapter.
I didn't see it. Is it there?
Yes, I think that I saw it.
Mahmoud, I'm sorry. Mahmoud, I want to hear your summary of this chapter. Read it to us, please.
Okay. Since the time of Columbus, explorers dreamed of a water passage across the North American ocean. President Thomas Jefferson shared this dream. He conceived the course of discovery to travel up the Missouri River to the Rocky Mountains and westward along possible river routes to the Pacific Ocean. Meriwether Lewis and William Clark led this expedition of 1806. Along the way, they filled hundreds of pages with observations of the geography, Indians, tribes, and natural history of the Trans-Mississippi West. Though most people believe that American history began with Christopher Columbus, they found evidence that there were people living in North America as early. Based on ancient rocks and hundreds of unreadable inscriptions engraved on rocks and painted on cavern walls, and dozen ancient alphabets, vocabulary was derived from a mixture of Greek and Egyptian hieroglyphics. All this means there were Egyptians, Libyans, and Celtic Epirians living together in 800 BC. No longer can we think of America as developing in cultures isolation. For the first time, fighting Celts from Spain and daring Semitic seafarers from Carthage, Libya, and Egypt must be included in America's heritage. However, Jefferson's goal to find a river route that link with the Pacific had failed.
Excellent job. Now, regarding vocabulary, definitely high level. Children wouldn't understand, but if you are familiar with the subject, once again, a very super description of what happened in the chapter. Wonderful job. Very pleased. It sounds pretty exciting, too. I want to hit a couple of words just for pronunciation. Santa, can you type this? Continent. And then Mahmoud, repeat after me, please. Continent.
Continent.
Geography.
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 Iberians.
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 Heritage.
Heritage.
Heritage. Keep the T. Heritage.
Okay. Heritage.
Perfect. Excellent job. I love it. Great, 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 great stuff. Exciting. Yeah. By mixing, you know, I loved what you did in a very small paragraph. You were able to mix all those different countries and people into America's ancient history. And it sounds very exciting. I really liked it. Good job.
Thank you.
All right. Let us go to the enormous crocodile. That sounds so scary. Sadaf has a summary for us. So I'm very excited to hear Sadaf's summary of this story. Now, Sadaf, I will tell you, I did not listen to this story. So I'm excited. Are you ready?
Yes.
Go for it.
Okay. In the biggest, brownest, muddiest river in Africa, there were two crocodiles. The not-so-big one just would eat fish, but the enormous crocodile was the greediest creature in the whole jungle, with hundreds of sharp white teeth, so that he would love eating children. Once in his idea, he had secret plans and clever tricks, which were really nasty, to catch a juicy child or even more for lunch.
Oh, that's so gross.
And in his way to town, he told any creature he met what he was going to do and where he wanted to go, so that every creature blamed him because of his ominous plans and wished him to be squished or cooked as well. But he grinned up at them and didn't care. Maybe the enormous croc was cunning, but on the other hand, the other animals in jungle didn't want his plan to be implemented. While he was trying all his ruses out, such as coconut tree, seesaw, merry-go-round, and picnic place, one by one, each time one of the animals foiled his plan and rushed to rescue kids before he could snatch and gulp them. They were Humpy Rumpy the hippo, Mugglewump the monkey, Roly-Poly the bird, and Turnkey the elephant. At last, Turnkey swung him faster and faster, and believe it or not, sent him to space, where he crashed into the sun and got exactly what he deserved. Mm. And I have some funny conclusions. One is, don't be too stupid to tell everyone what the hell you're going to do. Number two is, don't eat children because they have many supporters. All the animals, I mean.
Oh, that's great. That was a really wonderful
joke. I hope that everybody liked it because I was really laughing from morning till now that I was writing this one. And I didn't have time to make a summary for the next book.
Oh, you did a super job. That was great. And what's really nice was most children would absolutely understand what you said and would be scared and also would be laughing at the same time. That was great.
Because I'm the teacher of the students. I know I play with them every time.
Brilliant job. Brilliant.
Thank you.
Oh. Where are you from, Sadaf?
I'm from Iran.
Do you live in Iran?
Yes, yes.
Where do you live?
Uh-huh.
I'm originally of Iran. If you know Rasht, if you know the north of Iran.
The northern part. Big.
Yes.
You have bears giant. Up there.
Yes, yes.
You have bears? Rasht. Go ahead.
I didn't hear you.
Yeah, Marwa, can you mute your microphone, please? Thank you.
Okay.
So I was going to say, in northern Iran, you have bears.
Yes, yes. I also go and see them. I also feed them sometimes.
You feed the bears?
Yes, I don't afraid because my grandfather works in the jungle and he has a kind of dangerous job. I also sometimes go with him and I find the bears and at the far distance I see them and go little by little, not very near, but I just put the food and they come to me and eat it. They are also pigs. A lot of pigs we have.
Wow. Wow. So do you feed the bears little children?
Yes, yes. They are really nice.
No, I'm teasing. I'm teasing.
I just decided to have one bear at home, but they told me that it's impossible because the bears should be in jungles. I know because I really love the kids of the bears.
Oh, that's great. Yeah, the bear cubs.
Yes, very good. Yes,
oh, great. Excellent. Excellent job. Okay. Let me go to, I think, Mahmoud. Mahmoud works so hard. And everybody, Mahmoud has a job. So, Santa, take me down. This is it. Yes. Mahmoud, go for it.
Where is Marwa? Marwa not here today?
She's just echoing. Wow, wow.
An enormous greedy green crocodile lives in a swamp in Africa, wants for lunch some boys and girls, says all his friends. I am the only one who dares to leave the water and go through the jungle to the town to look for little children to eat. On the way to the town, he found four animals that he has gets into a fight with each of them because they believe he is dirty, brutal, and fiendish. They were a hippopotamus called Humpy Rumpy.
Oops. Hold up. I'm missing all that. We're missing a section, Santa. Fiendish.
He make it twice.
Okay. We're missing after fiendish. Can you maybe paste again?
you go up there.
Let's wait a second. While we're waiting, I do want to go back just 1 second, sorry, to Sadaf and the word creature, C-R-E-A-T-U-R-E. Don't say creature, say creature, creature, okay?
Okay, creature.
Yes.
Yes, thank you.
Yep. All right, there we go. So they believe is dirty, brutal, and fiendish. Mahmoud, keep going, please.
They were a hippopotamus called Humpy Rumpy, Trunky the elephant, Muggle Wump the monkey, and Roly Poly Bird. In the town, the crocodile thought many tricks for lunch and trying different things to deceive the children in class enough to be able to swallow them. But each time when he performed an idea, he missed, because one of the jungle animals who mocked on the way to the town warned children to run away. And in the end, the elephant delivers the crocodile to the sun.
Delivers, I like it. Keep going.
Finish.
Ah, that was great. Oh, what was the last part there? What's that? An enormous... Okay, good, good. That was great. I loved it. I loved it. Now, I have a suggestion for looking at today's summaries, which were great. You guys did a very, I think, one of the best days today. But I have a suggestion, and that is be careful with the length of your sentence. The longer your sentence, the more problems you're going to have. The shorter your sentence, the better. So why don't you try this? The next time you make a summary, go ahead and make a summary the way you want, you know, in English. Write your sentences. Don't worry about length. Just, you know, make it long, make it short, whatever you want. Then go back and look at your summary and see if you can make the same story but in shorter sentences. I hope you understand what I mean. And by doing that, you will probably recognize grammar mistakes and congruency mistakes that you have made. It's very common. The longer a sentence, the more problems will happen, will occur. The shorter the sentence, the easier the grammar. So try that. So next time, just make the, you know, just right away, blah, 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 and then check. And then maybe 2 weeks later after that, we'll do the opposite way. Make a summary, but really, really, really short sentences, and then try to make them longer. So for the next hangout, 2 weeks later, when you make your summaries, go ahead and write long sentences and then see if you can shorten them. And 1 month later, we'll do the opposite. 2 weeks later, Santa, 1 month later. There you go. 1 month later, we'll do the opposite. Make short sentences and then try to make them longer. Does that make sense, everybody?
Yes.
Now, the reason this is actually okay, Alex, I'm glad you mentioned that. The reason I'm telling you to do this is because this is speaking. So it's not really written stuff. It's not a written assignment. It's not a writing assignment. I actually prefer you guys to only speak. Writing is a totally different subject, and I don't like teaching writing because it actually takes a lot of time and people are at such different levels. Alex says he uses an online editor. Yeah, those are great. Microsoft works well. Hemingway editor sounds great. Grammarly.com is okay. You have to pay money for that one, though. And But what I'm saying is, you guys, your English is intermediate to advanced level, and you guys need to probably practice more speaking than writing. Now, writing is a problem, of course, but speaking is also a problem. And when you speak, grammar is less important. So that's why I don't really worry too much when your grammar is bad, okay? And you do have, there are many mistakes in the grammar. But I don't really worry about that, because when you're speaking, grammar is less important. Your story is much more important. However, even though grammar is less important, we still need to try to improve our grammar. The best way to improve our grammar is to use short sentences. And short sentences, once you get used to them, you can start making them longer. But how do you work on short sentences? By writing summaries. Seriously, writing a summary of a book is an excellent way to improve your spoken English grammar. But you need to write it short. And then, after you're confident with your short sentences, then you start making them longer and longer and longer. And then it will do wonders for your speaking. The same thing happened when I learned Korean. Short sentences in Korean, I was very good. The longer sentences, many problems. But after time, after practice, I became pretty good at all of it. Go ahead, Eva.
Okay, so I have one suggestion. So when we are familiar with the book or the chapter,
yeah.
So maybe it would be good for practicing our speaking that you ask a question we are not prepared for. And in a short time, we could say the idea. So not to be prepared, because when we prepare the summary, we think about it, and it's one thing. And when you told that it's important for us to speak, I think that it's better for us to practice like that.
You know,
I don't know, maybe
no, I'm gonna show you something that we do in Santa. I'm gonna take the mic, I'm gonna take control from you for a second. Hold on a second. So what Eva is saying is something that we actually do in my other classes. I have a screen, hold on a second. So this is my DDM class. Don't save. And in my DDM classes, I have a section called Let's Talk About It. And every assignment, I give students a bunch of questions that they have to just answer without thinking, without writing. And then I have, we have a PERF class. PERF is my speaking class. And in PERF, I do the same thing. We have a My PERF, and where you just have to talk about something without writing, without preparing. And I even say, don't make your sentences too long. Keep it short. Don't speak too fast. So this is something that I do with my students in PERF and DDM. And once again, I do this for the students not so that I check their grammar, but to get them speaking more. And then what we do is I share what they write. And hold on a second, I'll show you. Let's talk about it. So, and I'll just show you a little bit here. This is most recent Let's Talk About It. You can see a bunch of students have sent in recordings, and then other people can listen to their recordings and we talk about it and discuss it here. So your suggestion is great, but the only problem is I don't have a place where I can share everybody's recordings. With Perf and DDM, you know, we have a membership, so we use that service. And it's open just to the members, which we actually pay for. But the idea is great. I'll think about it, though. I don't want to do it in our Hangout because it does take a lot of time. But to have this type of option available is a great idea. I do like it, and I will think about it. Okay, Eva? And I encourage everybody, join DDM and join Perf and participate in those conversations if you can. Because what Eva is saying is true. Just having those questions without preparation is super excellent practice for your speaking. So if you are a DDM member or a Perf member, take advantage of the Let's Talk About It in My Perf and use it as Eva was suggesting there too. Let me give it back to Santa. Make presenter. We don't receive our last meeting May 7th. What do you mean?
We're talking about the newsletter.
Ah, the newsletter. Santa yelled at me yesterday.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Yes, that's my fault. And once again, to Santa, my sincerest apologies. But you have the recording, correct?
No.
No. The recording I put on Coach Shane's ESL channel. Hold on a second. I think that's where I put it. Yeah. So I'm going to take it from Santa again. Make presenter. There's so many buttons to hit. Here we go. Make presenter. Share screen. There we go. So if you guys go to Coach Shane's ESL YouTube channel, how do I get there? I have the last book clubs here. How do I get to the channel? I don't even know how to work this stuff. There we go, view channel. So the channel is right here, and I'll put this link down below in the chat room. Yes, that's right, Alex. So I am recording the Hangouts, and we have a couple of the book clubs here. So the last ones, you'll find them there. And yes, regarding your summaries and the editing, yeah, I need to do that. And I sincerely apologize, especially to Santa. But today I'm recording this Hangout too, and I will put it on this YouTube channel so that you guys can see it too. Yeah, so Sadaf is asking, Santa, what's next? Let me change the screen again. So chapter 9 and make presenter.
I haven't made the presenter yet.
All right, Santa, you're the presenter now. Okay, good. So our next meeting, June 4th, keep your summaries short. Master short sentences. The Suppressed History of America, Chapter 9, Friends in High Places. Ronad, is that how you spell it? Ronad Dahl? Ronald Dahl, thank you. The Magic Finger. That's the assignment. Are we doing chapter 10 too? Let's not. It's very long. So we're just going to do chapter 9. Just chapter 9. Yeah. Suppressed. One more S. The Suppressed History of America, chapter 9. Friends in High Places. This is when Lewis and Clark are done. And Ronald Dahl, The Magic Finger. Marwa, go ahead.
Yeah, the hero returned. Who is the hero?
The hero is Lewis. Meriwether Lewis.
Lewis? Sure.
He's the leader.
Or Dr. Fellow.
What's that?
Okay. I don't know if it's Lewis or Dr. Fell. I get confused.
Yeah, good point. Good point. Yeah, actually, perhaps for us, Dr. Fell might be the hero.
But he means the Lewis. Lewis. Okay.
Yes, that's right. Because Lewis was the commander. He did give up his command, but anyway, he left as the commander. He was the hero. Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Absolutely. Andre, are you sleeping?
I'm enjoying.
You're too kind. I see. So Adriana has had great points. Alex, in and out, great points. Eva, Mahmoud, Marwa, Rehab, Sadaf, all active. I just haven't heard from Andre very much, and I thought maybe he fell asleep. I'm very happy. This is a long day. I don't know. Some of you are members of DDM. We have DDM Live coming up in 45 minutes, and then again in 7 hours. So for me, it's a tough day. I got to do DDM explanation video today. Tomorrow is going to be a wonderful Sunday. Sergey, yeah, Sergey can't join today. Thanks, Santa. Sergey had something, but he plans on joining next week.
It's 2 weeks.
2 weeks, 2 weeks, 2 weeks. Thank you very much, guys. I hope that you have a fantastic Saturday and Sunday and Monday, blah, 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 the next 2 weeks. We have next meeting June 4th. I'm recommending shorter sentences. The Suppressed History of America, Chapter 9, Friends in High Places, and Ronald Dahl's, what is it? The Magic Finger. The Magic Finger. Interesting. Thanks a lot, guys. Take care. Have a great week. 2 weeks.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Take care.
You too.
Don't be shy next time. If you guys have questions or anything, please go ahead and ask.